Today, I'm gonna tell you everything you need to know about SD cards, and even some things you don't. Let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What is happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and today we're gonna be talking about SD cards. Now, this video was brought on because every single one of my cameras now has two SD card slots in it, and when you go to get a new camera that has new specs and new codecs, and you look online for the list of, like, what are the best SD cards to get, you actually get quite a few recommendations in there that are junk and shouldn't be recommended and don't really make any sense based on what you're searching for. So today I want to demystify all of the numbers and letters and designations that are on SD cards. And to do that, I decided today would be a fun day to do some macro video since I've got this macro lens for the Sony a7 III here and shoot some video on it. So we'll be shooting the SD card all zoomed in, and I'll point at some of the designations on the card and we'll go over it from there. Also, I want to give a quick shout out to Camera Canada for providing me with a lot of the hardware that I need in order to make the videos like these. So if you guys are Canadian like me and are looking to get some new camera gear, make sure you check out Camera Canada. Links will be in the description. Okay, so let's move over to the SD card here and just kind of take a look around, and I'll tell you what everything means and then what you need to look for when it comes to getting SD cards for video. Now, I should mention this is primarily for video because for photos, these settings are a lot more relaxed. So first up right here, you've got the speed, which on this card says 80 megabytes per second. Now, these speed designations are never really that useful to you, but they do give you a rough idea of what you should expect to read the card at when you take the files off of the card and put them on your computer. For instance, if you stick this card in a USB 3 card reader, you can actually get close to 80 megabytes per second offloading the files. But this isn't really that important in terms of figuring out how to match with the codec on your camera. Next up, we've got the size of the card right here at 32 gigabytes, and then we've got some branding above and below. Now let's get into this whole cluster stuff here, which is really more important to figuring out what the speed is. Now, these designations provide a better understanding of what the sustained write speed is, which is what's important when it comes to video recording. And again, not that important when it comes to photos, unless you're talking about big raw files and unloading a big buffer quickly and that kind of thing. But even for that, this number over here isn't as important as these numbers, even for the photo thing. So let's start with this number here that is in this sort of C circle, and the number is 10. Now, this is the one that you're gonna see most likely these days because any numbers lower than this aren't as easy to find because they're pretty outdated. But basically what this means is that you can expect to receive a sustained write speed of 10 megabytes per second, which is a lot lower than the 80 megabytes per second over here. But this is more about when it's in the camera and it's actually writing to the card in the camera. It's not the same speeds when you pull the files off using a card reader. Now, all these numbers we're talking about here are in megabytes per second, like the 10 megabytes. But when it comes to codecs in your camera, they're usually listed in bits, megabits per second. So when you convert that, it's very, very simple. You just multiply by 8. There's 8 bits in a byte. So something that can achieve 10 megabytes per second sustained write can achieve 80 megabits per second sustained write. That's basically how that works. Now let's jump over to the one inside of the U shape here. This is the UHS speed class, which is a 1 equals 10 megabytes a second, same as this here. So they have the same speed rating. They're just provided by two different classification systems. And this one here corresponds to this little I Roman numeral one that's located here to indicate that the card is a UHS-I card. And we'll get into UHS-I versus UHS-II in just a moment when I show you UHS-II card, but a great number of the cards that have been out for all the years prior to this would have been UHS-I. Now, the last thing we're gonna point out here is this section here, which says SDHC, and the SD part is obvious because it's an SD card, that's not gonna change, but the HC part will change. And this part is very, very, very important when it comes to video. Something that you'll see often recommended are cards that have affordable prices but are of an SDHC classification. And there's a problem with SDHC, which is that it uses the FAT32 file system. And that's basically the file system of how the files, when you record with your camera or you do something like that, how they're formatted and organized on the card. Now, one of the limitations of FAT32's file system is that you can't write files larger than 4 gigabytes. Anything beyond 4 gigabytes has to be split up and put into another file. So if you had 16 gigabytes of footage, you're gonna have 4 files. And this is very easy to do when you're recording 4K video. 4 gigabytes isn't a lot. And so anytime that you see SDHC here on the card, you know you're gonna be getting a FAT32 file system, which I don't think is very good for video these days. It's fine for photos, but I don't love it for video because of the breaking up of 4 gig files. Photos aren't gonna be over 4 gigs, so this is one of the things where photo and video differ in terms of what kind of cards to look for. Now, the next designation up from this would be SDXC, which I'm gonna show you a card like that right now. So this is an SDXC card, as you can see the X right there. That means it's using the exFAT file system as opposed to the FAT32. Now the advantage of the exFAT file system is it can record files much larger than 4 gigabytes. It can go up to 2 terabytes file, so you're never really, at least not for a long time, gonna be worried about separating your video files into multiple files. You can record them into one single file, move it over in your edit, and then chop it up that way, which I vastly prefer. Now an easier way to remember this is that the FAT32 file system, known as SDHC, it only goes up to 32 gigabyte cards, and then the SDXC or exFAT system starts at 32 gigabytes and goes beyond. Now there's not a lot of exFAT cards at 32 gigabytes, so it's probably easier to remember that 64 gigabytes and beyond are gonna be exFAT and be good for video for not splitting up into 4 gig files, and anything 32 gigabytes and smaller are gonna be FAT32 and will split up your video files into 4 gigabyte chunks. Now while we got this 64 gig card here, let's point out a couple of other features. You'll notice that this one here has a 3 inside of the U. That means UHS class 3, which means that it can write up to 30 megabytes per second sustained write speed for video, which is also designated here by the video class, which was introduced more recently than these other ones, V30, which means the same thing, 30 megabytes per second sustained write with video. Now, this speed class here hasn't changed from 10 because they don't have anything beyond 10. This basically says it can write 10 megabytes a second, which I guess means that it's okay for most, you know, photo files and that kind of thing. But when it comes to video, we're looking more for the V30, V60, V90, and the U3. Now, beyond, there's nothing really beyond U3 right now that I've seen, but there are V60s and V90s, which of course will mean that they can sustain writing speeds of video for 60 megabytes per second and 90 megabytes per second. So if we translate that into bits to know what kind of codecs they can cover, a V30 card here, multiply it by 8, that means that it can support a codec up to 240 megabits per second, which is great for pretty much most codecs that you're gonna find on something like a Sony, on a lot of the other ones that are hybrid video shooters. And that's obviously a lot more important, like we said, than the 95 megabytes per second here, which again, just pretty much means how fast you can take the files off the card. But still take note of the Roman numeral 1 here, that means it's still a UHS-I card. And if we flip the card over, you'll be able to see what UHS-I looks like. So as you can see, there is one set of pins here, which it has for transferring information in and out. Now if we look at a UHS-II card, you can see that the UHS-II card has a lot more contacts in order to transfer data on, so you're gonna be able to achieve a lot greater speeds. And if you flip these cards over, you'll be able to see what I'm talking about. Okay, so these cards are essentially identical, except for one is a UHS-II card, which you can see right here with Roman numeral 2. And one is a UHS-I card seen here with Roman numeral 1. They're both 64 gigs, they're both the Extreme Pro, but as you can see, there's a huge speed difference written here from SanDisk of 300 megabytes per second versus 95 megabytes per second. Now, if you are offloading files with UHS-II and you have to have a UHS-II card reader, a card reader that can have the same contacts, you can pull files off up to 300 megabytes per second, and it's quite fast. But you'll notice here that there is not really any updated designations. There's still the class 10, and there's still the U3. But obviously, you should be able to expect a lot better performance from these cards than the, you know, 10 megabytes per second that you're used to here and the 30 megabytes per second here, but it doesn't have a V30 rating. There are websites that have done benchmarks on this card with the GH5, and its video sort of sustained writing speeds come in around 80 to 90 megabytes per second. So if we multiply that by 8, then we know that we're gonna be able to get around 600 to 700 megabits per second codec, and the fastest codec on the GH5 currently is that 400 megabit per second all-I. So these cards are definitely capable of the highest level codecs that you can get on sort of small SD card cameras right now. Now in the future, there may be faster codecs that require, you know, even bigger SD cards. This guy in here, the V30, which obviously 30 megabytes a second times 8 is gonna be 240 megabits per second. If you have any kind of reasonable codec where it's 100, 200 megabits per second, this should be fine, and this is actually one of the cards that I would recommend because it has SDXC, so we know it's not gonna break up the files into 4 gigabytes. It's got the V30, so we know we can handle most of the codecs in the Sonys, Olympus, Fuji, anything that takes SD cards and does like video as like a secondary function, the V30 should cover you. And then these designations aren't as important if we see V30, but if you have a card that doesn't say V30, but it does have a U3, then you know it's also good for 30 megabytes per second, which should also provide support for those codecs into the 1 to 200 megabit per second range. up to 240 theoretically. So based on all this information, the starting point that I would recommend for an SD card if you want to do video would be this one, bang for buck wise. This is the SanDisk Extreme Pro. It's the one that I was showing you there. It's a 64 gigabyte card, and it's an SDXC, obviously, because you can't get SDHC on a 64 gigabyte card, which means it's not going to split up your files. It has a V30 rating, so it should support pretty much anything, the G9, the GH5, all of its codecs except for the crazy all-I one. The Sony a7 III, all those cameras will have, this card will support the codecs, and you can get bigger sizes if you want, but I probably wouldn't go below 64 gigs, one, because of the SDXC thing, you don't want your files split up, and two, because 4K footage takes up space quickly. On the GH5, when I use its 150 megabit per second codec, I get about an hour with a 64 gigabyte card. So if you're using 100 megabit per second codec like the Sony, you're obviously gonna be able to get a little bit longer, like an hour and a half. But when you're looking to get a card, start here, and then it doesn't have to be SanDisk, by the way, just look for those specs on any given card because the designations aren't provided just by SanDisk. They're sort of a universal class. So look for a card that has all those features and then think to yourself, I'm gonna get about an hour to an hour and a half every 64 gigabytes, and then look for the bang for the buck of how much recording time that you think you're gonna need. And then also price out, if your camera has two card slots, think about getting two of the same cards because it'll be better if you wanna do redundant backup recording, or if you wanna be able to record from one to the other in relay and know exactly how long you have, well, you're gonna have obviously double of the first card. So price that in when you're thinking about getting cards. Think about which one can I get two of, because I think that'll produce a better result for you. But if you are planning on doing backup recording, remember that you only get one of these. So if you're gonna get a 64 gig and another 64 gig and do backup recording, you only get 64 gigs flat. So if you wanna be able to record 2 to 3 hours, maybe get two 128 gig cards if you're planning on doing backup recording. Anyway, that's gonna be it. I know I said a lot of numbers and letters and designations, but I just think this information is crucial, and I hope that I conveyed it to you well, because I don't want you buying SD cards that aren't gonna be useful to you or not give you enough headroom, because there's pretty much no resale value on SD cards and you can't really take them back. So I want you to get the right card that's right for you, and I think that there's a lot of sort of weird information out there when it comes to best cards for, you know, this and that camera. If you know the designations, then you can ignore those lists and just read the card for exactly what you need for the job you're trying to get done. Anyway, that's going to be it for me. I hope you found this video helpful or at least entertaining, and if you did, make sure you leave it the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, feel free to hit the dislike button twice. All right, I'm done.